and they are right here with me in studio. The hashtag is 0101, or use the SMS number 22422 to talk to Morgan Heritage. Reggae favorites, Morgan Heritage, have been nominated for one of the most prestigious awards in music. That's the coveted Grammy and the Best Reggae Album category. Morgan Heritage have a rich musical legacy and are undoubtedly one of contemporary reggae's most powerful forces on the global arena. The reggae group, or quintet, if you like, comprises siblings Peter Morgan, who does the vocals. There's Una Morgan, that's the girl. She does the keyboard and the vocals as well. Gramps Morgan, he's on the keyboards and he also does the vocals as well. And there's a Luke Morgan, he does the rhythm guitar, and Mojo Morgan, who does the percussion and vocals. And lately, rumor has it that Morgan Heritage have relocated to Kenya. And tonight we want to find out how true is this. And indeed, why? With me in studio tonight, very excited to be hosting Pete Morgan and Mojo Morgan.
Yes.
Wagwan, that's the only thing I know.
That's cool.
How are you? Good to
we're
see you guys.
Great. We're doing great.
Yeah, we would have hoped to have all of you guys here, but we're happy to have you nevertheless.
True.
Let me start with you. You're the lead singer.
Yes, ma'am.
Talk to us about, you know, growing up in this musical family. Your father being a celebrity.
Yes.
Talk to us about your upbringing.
I mean, the greatest thing about growing up as a family, our father didn't, and our mothers didn't let us get caught up into the music and the limelight of the music, but we were more in tune to just being brothers and sisters and taking care of friends and family. So that family unity, that spiritual essence keeps us grounded no matter where we go in the world. How many stages we perform on, or in front of how many different people, we are still just who we are.
Right.
At the end of the day, you know?
Right. And Mojo, let me talk to you. I mean, growing up in this musical family, did you ever feel as if music was dictated to you? Like, could you have preferred perhaps to do something else, or any of your siblings for that matter? Did you guys feel like this was forced on you?
No, we all had the choice to do different things, you know, growing up. Peter was into astrology. You know, actually was 3 years into law school when we got signed to MCA Records in the early 90s. I mean, I had aspirations to be an architect, or Gramps actually had scholarship to the University of Miami to play football. But I mean, when you're called to do something, it's important in life to answer that calling, and music called us from a very early age. And we're thankful to our father and mothers for, you know, guiding us and nurturing the talent that we've been blessed with from the Most High.
Right. And I want to talk about the song that you feel did it for you, the song that you feel catapulted you to fame. I'm sure it's hard to pick out of, you know, all the songs you've done, but here in Kenya we have particular favorites. I know we've been playing some music and you've been saying that's like 7 years old, but for us,
true.
I mean, those are songs that are forever in our hearts. So
give
for
thanks,
you guys, which
thanks.
Song?
I mean, there's, like you say, different territories there. Different songs that really made it big. Like here in Africa, songs like Don't Have to Dread to the Rasta, Nothing to Smile About, Down by the River, She's Still Loving Me. And the list can go on, you know, but there's like one particular song that is loved by people everywhere we go. It's a song called Don't Have to Dread to the Rasta.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Can you guys do a little bit of it for me?
Don't have to dread to be Rasta. You don't have to dread. This is not a dreadlocks thing, divine conception of your heart.
Yay!
Yeah, you know.
That is amazing. And let's listen into a bit of that song. I know a lot of you love it. Do we have that ready? Okay, we don't have that ready quite yet. But let's continue and we'll play that song for you shortly. Misconceptions about dreadlocks, Pete. Let's talk about that. A lot of parents and, you know, just the craze with a lot of kids, you know, particularly teenagers wanting to grow their hair out, wanting to have dreadlocks, and then parents, the conservative ones, saying no because of the misconception about dreadlocks. Let's talk about this misconception.
Yeah, a lot of people feel like, you know, dreadlocks, it's nasty, it's dirty, but we tell people, look, I probably wash my hair more than people who don't have locks. You have to keep it clean, you have to keep it fresh, you know, you got to keep it smelling good. Like Mojo said, the berries and the juices, you know, so there's nothing wrong with it. And if a person desires to wear locks, that's their personal choice. It has nothing to do with the religion of Rastafari, because before Rastafari, you know, there were warriors in Kenya who wore locks. you know, from the ancient times who helped to fight for the liberation of Kenya or Ethiopia. There are many warriors of Africa that were locked long before Rastafari come around, you know. So it's just an ancient African culture that we adapt to and want to be a part of and to
How
remember.
How old are yours? How long have you had yours?
Since 98.
Almost so 20 years. Decades.
Yeah.
Wow. What about yours? Yours are shorter though.
Mine's?
Yeah.
No. It's
pretty long.
Long. Yeah. I just like sucking on me.
Yeah.
I've had mine since I was a baby.
Since you were a baby. Old, yeah. Wow. Okay. Interesting. Now to the big question that everybody's asking. You guys were in Kenya just the other day.
Yeah.
What brings you back to Kenya so soon?
We love it.
Yeah.
We love being here. You know, it reminds us of one of our other homes in Jamaica. So we're happy to call this one of our homes.
Okay, Pete, let me hear some more from you. So are you guys officially living in Kenya now? Is this where people can find you? Is this your home base now?
Well, whenever we're in Africa, if someone wants us to go to Malawi like we did the other day, or Addis Ababa like we did the other day, anywhere in Africa, they're gonna have to fly us from Nairobi.
Yes, and why in particular Nairobi? I know you've been here before. Before you came in last year, you'd been here I think 7 years prior. Came in last year, did this amazing concert, and are now back again. So what is it about Nairobi in particular that has just taken your breath away?
Well, we love Nairobi. The people of Nairobi, and everywhere we play in the world, you know, 9 times out of 10 there's a Kenyan in our audience. You know, you all represent yourselves globally.
Mm-hmm.
And I said big up to all Kenyans wherever on the day. You know what I mean? And you know, we love West Africa, East Africa, South Africa, North Africa. We have enough friends and families in Senegal, Gambia, in Ghana, Ivory Coast. Our brother lives in Addis Ababa. But Kenya has just been very good to us, and we are working with a lot of different people here to help become a part of the African community, the African society across the continent,
mm-hmm.
you know, while making Kenya headquarters.
Mm-hmm. Mojo, let me talk to you about, you know, your plans while in the country, investment-wise, production-wise. Do you plan to develop talent while you're in the country?
Definitely. Our label that released our album, our Grammy-nominated album,
mm-hmm.
Strictly Roots, it's called CTBC Music Group. It stands for Cool to the Conscious. So we're launching CTBC International, that's dedicated to develop young talent in Africa, and not just young talent, but even artists that are established in their country, but it doesn't go beyond those borders. We want to send much love to people like Big Kev and the True Black, who brought us here in October. We got to meet different corporate brands like Coca-Cola and things of that nature in Africa that we're looking forward to possible collaborations down the road. The UNEP, UNEP, is we're in talks with them, and UN Women in Malawi,
mm-hmm.
for the He for She campaign that's focused on getting 1 million signatures around the world for, you know, ending violence against women. I know you support that.
Yes, I do.
Yeah, so it's just about the music and philanthropy for us. When we're being in Africa, being home, it's bigger than us. It's bigger than just doing what we normally do as Morgan Heritage.
Mm-hmm. Right, and so you guys would describe yourselves as Afrocentric. I know you've lived for a better part of your lives in the U.S.,
Absolutely.
In Jamaica,
Absolutely.
But your passion for Africa, what is it about Africa that is exciting you recently?
It's not a recent thing. It's just since we know ourselves as people, we are African that were born abroad.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? From your black, you're African. It don't matter where you come from. And it's only being true to yourself when you identify your root, your DNA. Your DNA can't lie. You know what I mean? So it's just a joy for us to be here amongst the people who have shown us so much love throughout the years.
Mm-hmm.
And when we're here in Africa, anywhere we go in Africa, there's so much love that the people share with us. And we want to give that love back to Africa.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like Mojo said, it's just another place that we call home. We have Jamaica, we have America, and now we have Africa.
Right. And we'll be talking about your album, Strictly Roots. This is the album that has been nominated for a Grammy, and how huge is that? But before we get into that, a lot of you are requesting for your all-time favorite jam from Morgan Heritage. Let's listen in.
A dreadlock thing, divine conception of the heart. Well, you don't have to a dreadlock thing. Divine conception of the heart. Yeah. It's a life of a liberty lived by the fathers of our history. Of all the ancient and prophecy, trust in the power of the Trinity. Yeah. Got to believe in His majesty. Oh yes, His lineage and divinity. The first step is sovereignty, knowing oneself to royalty. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You don't have to dread to see Rasta. No, have to dread. This is not a dreadlock thing. Divine conception of the heart. You don't have to dread to see Rasta. This is not a dreadlock thing. Divine conception of the heart.
And there you have it. So the album Strictly Roots, your 10th studio album. Yeah. This is huge. This has earned you guys your first Grammy.
Yeah.
Did you ever imagine that this could happen when you were recording this album? Your thought process, were you actually going for a Grammy?
Well, not necessarily, but every album we record, we hope for this type of recognition.
Yes.
I mean, every album we record, it's recognized by the people, which is most important to us because, you know, you all bring us here. You bring us home to Africa because how much you love the works we've done. But what makes this album special, and it's really just divine will, because this is the first album that we put out that it's totally independent. We've done everything on our own. We are our own label. We've marketed and promoted everything on our own. And this is the first one that's been nominated for the most prestigious award in music globally, which is the Grammy Award.
Uh-huh.
You know, so it means a lot to us that it's this album that was nominated for a Grammy.
Yeah, and you know, of course, it's been nominated under the Best Reggae Album category. Catch the Grammys next month. So do you think you'll give Luciano and JQ a run for their money? I know they've also been nominated under the Fame category. How are you feeling? I know it's a pretty nervous time for you guys, but do you think you actually did a better job than them? I know that's an unfair question, but seriously.
You know, for us, the nomination is about the music. And it's to get, there's so many albums that are released on an annual basis. You're talking about dozens, if not hundreds of albums. So when we're able to get to this, like Peter said, this level of recognition, we're grateful just for that. Okay. The win is icing on the cake. So it's not about whether we win it or not, or who are we competing against, because we all put our best foot forward every time we release music to the people. And the people is what really matters.
Well, you have my vote. If at all we're voting, I hope you guys bag it. So are you attending?
Yes, we'll be attending.
You'll be attending the Grammys.
Yes.
Good stuff. Okay, so DJ Crossfade is with us in studio. I want to listen in to one of your songs from the Strictly Roots album. Which is your favorite, actually? Which one? I know, you might not have the same favorite. Which one do you particularly like? Which one is your particular favorite?
I mean, lately we've been listening to Wanna Be Loved, track number 7, a lot because we're about to launch the video.
Yes.
Next week, Monday.
How many tracks in the album?
There's 12.
12, okay. Mm-hmm.
So Wanna Be Loved is the one that we've been listening to on a regular basis.
Okay, let's listen in. Feel free to sing along.
When all it is everyone just wants to be loved, yeah. And we no gonna be judged, all we want is love. Everyone I believe, all we want is love. We need more, we want more, we got one more. Love, yeah. Whether you come from the ghetto, you wanna be loved. Whether you come from the birth, you wanna be loved. Everyone just wants to be loved. Yeah.
the Strictly Roots album, and I love the message in that song. Wherever you are from, you want to be loved.
Truly.
So the underlying messages in most of your songs, what is that? What vibe do you try to give out in your music generally?
It's strictly love, you know, for humanity. You know, no matter who you are, your race, your color, it's just hoping that one day humanity can really live as one. You know, there's so much division because of politics and religion and, you know, who you are and where you come from, but we're hoping that we can live in a world where none of that means nothing. It's just about loving each other, you know what I mean?
Yeah, well said. Mojo, let me talk to you about your decision to feature Shaggy in the album, among other artists, of
right.
course. What was this about? Why didn't you just do a Morgan Heritage affair? Why particularly did you feel the need to work with certain artists in this album?
Shaggy is a fellow Brooklynite, you know, Jamaican band, but grew up in Brooklyn. And this is like what, our third collaboration together. We collaborate on his projects and our projects. He's our brother. But it's this album in particular, we wanted to show the globalization of reggae music. It's no longer a music created in Jamaica, brought to the world via Jamaica. You have African reggae artists, you have European reggae artists, you have North American reggae artists, Polynesian reggae artists. So we wanted to show that the future of reggae music is bright due to this fact, due to the influence that our culture and our music has around the world, you know. And we're looking forward to show that, you know, not only releasing music but performing live in Africa more. You know, we're coming this spring on a Strictly Roots African tour, going to several countries, Zimbabwe, Malawi, hopefully coming back to Kenya, and a few other places, Ethiopia. And we just look forward to doing that and bringing some of our colleagues on an annual basis.
Okay, great, great. And we wish you all the best once again, and as far as the Grammys are concerned, of course, very exciting to know that you guys will be in Kenya. So Kenyan collabos in your future project, do we hope?
Oh yeah,
do you guys
sure.
working with any Kenyan artists? Do you have any in particular that you're keen on working with?
There's a few, we'll keep it quiet, but we have done a combination with Wire. I want to say big up to Wire, anyway, and a good friend of ours, family to us, you know. And there's so much others, and we just don't want to work with just who's known, but also who is not known, you know, to
right.
help give them recognition, you know. So we're looking forward to doing a lot of work with a lot of artists across the continent. So to So is a group that we love in Kenya right now, so hopefully we'll do something together with them.
Okay, somebody here writing in and saying, Morgan Heritage, a lot of people from the slums identify with reggae music, at least that is here, and they're asking whether you have felt the need, you know, corporate social responsibility, just charity-wise, to reach out to the youth, perhaps in the low-income earning settlements or societies, who need that message more and who understand perhaps your message more, you know,
sure.
the youth that are dealing with perhaps drugs, unemployment. You know, somebody here saying, you seem to be very business oriented. Are you giving back? Are you reaching out to the societies, particularly here in Kenya, that love reggae?
This is a part of why we want to be here, because there's a great part of Africa where, like you say, in the slums, there's so much talent there. But who's going to take the time to go down there and be with the people and let them know that their future bright, because they have the talent to make their own future bright? So, you know, we've not been here much time yet, but this is all a part of what we want to do. We want to become a part of the community, a part of the society, and really connect with the youth, them in the ghettos, in the slums, that really feel our music and connect to it. You know, we want to be a part of their lives as much as they have made us a part of their lives.
And we've taken those steps. You know, when we were here in October for Extravaganza, we went and visited one of the slums, the Korogocha slums, and, you know, gave our commitment to the Miss Scotch Kenya
yeah.
program and their efforts in educating you know, the future leaders of Africa, you know, Kenya in this case. So when you hear us talk about our philanthropic efforts and working with organizations like UNEP and UN Women, that's what it's founded on. It's
right.
about making sure that we have that, you know, social responsibility and give back, because what is it worth if we gain the world and then we we do nothing with it.
And I want to talk about the herb. I don't know how you guys say that. Ganja, you know, weed. And the fact that, you know, reggae, you know, you go for a reggae concert, you can sort of smell it in the air. Like, somehow a lot of reggae societies or the youth, and not even just, I'm not going to just say reggae, but generally a lot of youth are known to be smoking weed. It's said to be coming from this whole reggae movement thingy. What do you want to say about that?
It's, it's not a good stigma. Yeah. Because we don't smoke weed.
So that is stigma.
Yeah, it's a stereotype. We don't smoke weed.
Yeah.
Oh, you think this man can sing like that and smoke weed?
I don't smoke. I don't drink alcohol. I don't smoke weed.
Because you're a rasta, so you don't need weed.
That has nothing to do with either. Mm-hmm. That's just my personal choice.
You don't smoke weed?
I have rasta that smoke and you have rasta that drink alcohol. But me personally, I don't.
So you, know what I mean? So you don't smoke weed?
No, I don't. I don't smoke weed, I don't smoke cigarettes, I don't smoke crack.
What about you?
You know, it's not whether anyone smokes weed. You know, herb is a thing that has benefit for, you know, multiple ailments. You know, if you look in the United States where we were born and raised, marijuana is legal in over 20 states right now. Mm-hmm. And that trend is spreading across the world because it has its benefits. So we don't want people to see, like, when you go to a Morgan Heritage show, it's about weed. Mm-hmm. That's not what, even though we're advocates, that's not what we're about. Because we believe that something grown in its natural state that's not processed in any way, shape, or form, like alcohol, these pharmaceutical drugs that they give us, that they claim help us, and all they do is cause other problems. You're taking a pill for your stomach and all of a sudden your head hurts, your heart is hurting, and you got to take another pill for that problem. You don't have those issues when you smoke herb. And I would tell you that maybe if more people smoke herb, the world would be a little more easy.
Well, for each their own, but for Pete, to Pete, who actually, Peter does not smoke it, does not drink, does not smoke cigarettes either. You know, a word.
I don't smoke crack either.
You don't smoke crack? Yeah, you don't smoke crack either. And I just want to talk about, I mean, seriously, because for the message, when you look at music videos nowadays, and particularly the target audience being the younger persons, when you see, like, there's this song called Baking Soda, when you see songs such as this, you know, actually being produced and put out there to air and making weed smoking or crack cocaine look like it's cool, what message are we sending to the young people? And what do you want to say about that? You, who doesn't drink and who doesn't smoke and who doesn't do crack as well.
Well, me personally, I mean, I cannot tell an artist how to paint their picture.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? But I know what I do. I know my responsibility. When I have hundreds of thousands and millions of fans listening to my music and look to me as an inspiration, I am aware of what message I want to share with them. And if I'm going to look at a child and say, look, I'm not telling you not to smoke, but I'm telling you know why you smoke.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Because not smoking is my personal choice. And it works for me. Maybe another person needs to smoke because of certain other issues that they have. So it's just a balance and understanding who you are and what you need from what you don't need. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Okay, so you've heard it from Morgan Heritage. They're not saying you should smoke weed. Just because you go for their concert doesn't mean you should light it up and, you know.
Come for the music.
Just go for the music.
The music.
Let's light up the world with love, not with marijuana.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, good. Well said. Well said. And the hashtag is one on one. What are your thoughts? We'll be reading out your tweets shortly. But, you know, on the brighter side of things, away from the marijuana and what have you, Kenya, what have you guys tried in terms of food? Where have you been?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Ugali, it reminds me of the what they call swallow in West Africa, you know, pounded yam and ngari and them thing there.
Yeah.
So it's nice, you know.
Can you're not cooking it yourself, it's been cooked for you.
Not yet, I haven't mastered it, we're working on it.
We're going to learn.
We're going to learn, yeah.
What about
learn.
You, Peter?
I mean, I've been trying, I don't eat meat. So most of what I've been eating is a lot of the fish here.
Mm-hmm.
Kenyans love tilapia, so I'm eating a lot of tilapia. fish from Lake Victoria, you know. So I love the way it's prepared here. The way you do your spinach here in Kenya.
Yeah.
It's one
and
of my
kales,
favorites.
Which is the kale. From Awiki.
Yeah.
Do you guys know where the...
You know, the funny thing is someone told me that kale in Kenya is poor people food.
No, that's arguable.
But listen, what I'm saying is, you know how expensive it is to buy kale in America or Jamaica?
Mm-hmm.
Like, Kenyans don't realize how fortunate they are to have kale just growing
wild
everywhere.
I
wish I could just walk on the street and pick it every day.
And I'll tell you something you didn't know. You know, kale is called Sukuma Wiki. Can you say that?
Sukuma Wiki.
Sukuma Wiki.
Sukuma Wiki.
Do you know how that came about?
No.
It basically means, translation into English means push the week. So Sukuma Wiki was called Sukuma Wiki because it was how people would actually push to the end of the week because it was cheap and affordable. So Sukuma Wiki.
Well, I'm glad it's cheap and affordable because I'll be buying a lot of it.
And that's good for the people.
So now you know.
We love chai tea.
Chai tea.
Not this
Kenyan
foolishness,
chai.
The real Kenyan chai tea. I go to these restaurants and I'm like, give me the real Kenyan chai that I go to Tigoni and get.
Yeah. Good. You're becoming great ambassadors. Okay. So, looking, you know, now that you're in Kenya, let's talk about your spouses, your girlfriends. I don't know if you're married or whatever. Family. So how do you plan to balance work life and family? You're here now. Did you come along with your family?
Not yet. I mean, yeah, sometimes you have to go and prepare a place before you can bring others with you, you understand?
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, like we said, we have family in Jamaica, America, and here in Africa. So, the earth is the largest and the fullness thereof. And
so,
we have
you have family in Jamaica, America, and here. I'm talking about your wife.
Yeah,
your
our wife and
Kenya,
children.
No,
they're in America.
Okay.
They're in America. Yeah.
Yeah,
man. It's difficult. It's a difficult time, like Peter said, for us to be away for weeks and months at a time, like you said, preparing a place for them to come.
Mm-hmm.
We do definitely look forward to enjoying Kenya outside of Nairobi.
Yeah.
You know, go visit the Serengeti and these beautiful, you know, wonders of the world that Kenya has. You know, it's more than just Nairobi and this metropolitan monster that you guys have created here. Kudos to all Kenyans loving it.
The metropolitan monster.
Oh yeah.
Everywhere you drive, you see a mall.
Yeah.
You know, you can find literally every designer item here in Kenya.
Yeah.
So
it's great. Yeah. And what makes us proud is, in the Western world, all they say of Africa is we got starving children, violence, terrorism, and the same thing that's going on here is what's going on in the Western world. And when we come to Kenya, or when we come to anywhere in Africa, 95% of the people that are on these flights are white people from Europe, mainly from Europe,
America.
And then you have the Asians from Asia.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm like, what do they see in Africa that we're not seeing?
Mm-hmm.
Or what do they know about Africa that they're not telling us? So we have to come find out for ourselves and come and realize that Africa is just as beautiful as New York City, Los Angeles, Miami, you know, anywhere else in the world. You come right here in Nairobi, you ain't missing nothing.
Truth well said.
Yeah.
I'm so excited. Your love for Kenya. You know, sometimes people call Kenya Africa and we get so offended because we're like, Kenya's not Africa. Kenya's just Kenya. Okay, we're in Africa.
I'm going to Africa.
Mm-hmm. Say, I'm going to
Kenya. Specifically.
Yeah. So let's take a look at your tweets as we begin to close. Let's take a look at what you're saying. The hashtag is 101 or SMS us on 22422. We want to know what your thoughts are. Okay, so your tweets are scrolling there. All right. So guys, as we close, are we expecting a concert in Kenya, Nairobi, actually? People are writing from Eldoret, Mombasa, Nakuru. Everybody is saying, please come and visit.
We want to perform these other places.
Mm-hmm.
We want to go to Nakuru. We want to go to Kisumu. We want to go to Mombasa. We want to do concerts in these different cities across Kenya.
Mm-hmm.
We've played Nairobi probably twice already.
Mm-hmm.
And we will play Nairobi again,
Jah
willing, you know?
Yeah.
But we want to play in other places. Like if we were in America, we wouldn't just play New York all the time.
Mm-hmm.
We play Los Angeles, we play Miami, we play Washington, D.C. And that's the same way we want to see Kenya.
I want to talk about your sister, Yuna.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I know previously you guys, when you were around with Graham, she didn't come along with you guys.
Mm-hmm.
And your brothers as well didn't come along. Let's talk about her being the only girl in the band.
Yeah.
How has that been over the years, the consistency, just keeping up with the energy from this almost all-male cast? Let's talk about Yuna.
She's an inspiration. If you look at the footage of Morgan Heritage, you see that Yuna lost a lot of weight.
Yeah.
So she's she has more energy than us sometimes, you know, and she balances us, all this testosterone, you know what I mean, and the egos and stuff, you know, and she brings that earthly balance to the, you know, the sun energy that and that lion vibe where we're bringing more time, you know, so it's always fun having her. She's our older sister, and she keeps us in line.
How does she lose all that weight, by the way? That's
exercise
what every girl wants.
Right.
She's changed her eating. She's eating right. I mean, when you get older, you have to, you want to continue living long and healthy, you have to change a lot of things. The things that you can eat when you're in your 20s and just work it off just because of youth, you can't do that in your 30s and your 40s or your 50s. So she's just been paying attention to a lot of what she's putting in her body and how she's taking care of
it. She looks great.
Thank you. She looks amazing.
Okay, guys, I think that's all the time we had for now. I want to know who's older between the two of you, between Mojo.
I'm older.
You're older?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm the big brother.
You're the big brother.
Yeah, I'm the baby in the group. So follow us on social media since I'm the baby in the group.
Yeah.
We trending, you know, at Morgan Heritage, #1on1, #CTVC, Strictly Roots.
Yeah, and what are you closing with us? I can't believe you guys won't even sing something really, really tiny, something just a little snippet, just something short from one of your favorites. Please, as we close.
What's your favorite?
My favorite is Down by the River. I love that.
I'll be down by the river. Waiting for the good Lord to pass my way. Oh, yeah. I'll be down by the river. Singing songs of joy on this lovely day. There you go.
Wow.
You guys sleep good tonight.
You guys, I'm sleeping real good.
Nice.
I'm sleeping real good tonight.
Nice.
And you guys are getting that Grammy. I mean, Kenya is behind you. Thank you so much for the love for our beautiful country.
Yeah.
We're going to be sending our love out on Twitter, on social media, everywhere. We do hope that you bag that Grammy. You truly deserve it. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. We've been hanging out
with Peter Morgan and Mojo Morgan on #1on1. The hashtag is #1on1. Please continue talking to us and talk to them on their social media handle as well. What is it? At Morgan Heritage.
Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Tumblr, any one of them. We're there. Royal Family on Facebook. You know, Africans love Facebook.
Yeah, we keep saying Facebook is so 2002, but we're still there.
Heavily.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much for watching. We'll see you again tomorrow. Good night.
No matter where you come from, no matter how you live your life, no matter how you pray, everyone just wants to be here. No matter where you tell them, however they perceive you, so they believe anyway. What a mess of society when only